us. Kind of just ask you to pray. Some friends of ours from Edgewood, and it's actually the guys in Tyler's cousin, Josh Lumpkin, had a massive brainstem stroke Sunday night at his home. He's got a 24-year-old wife, let's see, 32, and he passed away today. They've been married about 5 months. We've grown up with Josh's wife, and then we were at Edgewood with Josh for the last several years and got to know him. So it's been really surprising and really difficult. Surprising to us, not surprising to God, I know. But still, it hurts the flesh and it hurts. So I'd ask that you pray for the families there, that'd be the Lumpkins and the Swindles. And then also, April and I have a friend, his name's Michael Moore. He is, I don't know, was he 38? Right, 38, and he has advanced colon cancer. And he just had a major surgery on Friday, and from what I understand, it didn't go as they wanted it to. And we saw him last night, and he's very frail. And loves the Lord and has been probably one of the best examples of godliness during sickness I've ever seen. And it's difficult to watch. It's very difficult to watch. But I ask you to pray and to keep him in your prayers and your thoughts as the week continues. Michael Moore is his name. And he has a wife, Sarah, and they have 3 children that are right under the age of 6. And it's some major life stuff. And I don't always understand what God's doing, but I trust that he does. So let's pray for them real quick before we get started. Lord, I love you, and I thank you. I thank you that I don't have to understand, God. That I can trust you even in this, God. And just know that you have all things work for the good of those who love you, God. And I'm just going to love you. And I'm going to trust you. And believe that there's a large part of life that I just don't know yet. And that there's a large part of eternity and things that will happen after I cease to live here, God, that I just don't understand yet. But that they're good and that you've prepared them for us. Whenever we go to those things, God, we go to them. And I think it'll make sense to us then. But it's hard for it to make sense to us now. And so I just pray that you would help that family, the Swindles and the Lumpkins, give them peace in the midst of chaos and turmoil. And then in Michael Moore's life, God, I pray that you would work a miracle, God, and that you would heal his cancer. And you'd bring him out of it, God, and give him more time, Lord. You gave Hezekiah more time when he asked you. And I pray you do the same for my Lord God. And so I thank you for this night that we get to be together. Those of us that have came out tonight, I pray that we would honor you in what we do. Amen. Bear with me tonight. The voice is struggling a little bit. We were in the funeral home last night. My sister-in-law, her grandfather passed away. We were in Rainsville. Today I was in the funeral home. Randy's aunt passed away. Brandy and Kevin's aunt passed away. Myrtis Fowler. And I suspect I'll be in the funeral home again in a few days. So pray for us as we kind of just go through life. It's just part of it. I've went years before without having to go to funerals. But here lately, it seems like we get to go to a bunch of them. And so I just ask for strength for those that were due. All right. Acts chapter 14.
I didn't think it would let you.
Well, if it'll let you progress me through, my friend. I'm having to use a new version of PowerPoint. Actually, it's an old version. Hey, there we go. That's it. All right, let's start right there, guys.
Let's click over.
Can you move that so that we don't hide whatever's in the corner there? Yeah, thank you. All right, so what we're looking at here is a map of Paul's journeys. Now, look how far that is. About 2 inches is 200 miles. So every inch or so is 100 miles. Now imagine that's your area of impact during your lifetime. Not to mention that your life was cut short due to they wanted to kill you, and it did. entered in Damascus, and he goes to Antioch, Tarsus, Derbe, Lystra, Iconium, Antioch, Pisidia. These are all the places that we've been studying. And you can kind of get an idea. It's kind of interesting how it all loops back around and how it loops in these different places. But look how far it is from Damascus to Thessalonica. I don't know how long it took Paul to get there, but I would imagine quite a while. Because in some of these places, he stayed, like one of these places in particular, I know he stayed a year. And this was his lifetime. It's pretty interesting how it all plays out. And we'll go through some of these places tonight. We'll come back to that. But if you would, go ahead and go to my next one, guys. I really wish this would work. Oh, I didn't control anything. All right, verse 1 of Acts chapter 14. At Iconium, Paul and Barnabas went, as usual, into the Jewish synagogue. Now, one thing you're going to notice about these journeys is that they start often when they go into a city at the synagogue. They go to the religious center of the city, and that's where they start. And that's where they started last time in chapter 13 as well. They went into the synagogue, they got into it with the Jews and the Gentiles, and then the Gentiles ended up accepting the Lord, and the Jews kind of ran them out of town. And they started again at the Jewish synagogue. And it says, there they spoke so effectively that a great number of Jews and Greeks believed. Now, what did we talk about last week? Is if you are knowledgeable, your peers will listen to the things that you have to say. But when you're not knowledgeable, a lot of people are going to turn you off. So how important is it for us to know what we believe and why we believe it? Because if you can't talk about what you believe, why would anybody else want what you have? And so that's what we're getting at. It says, because they spoke so effectively, a great number of Jews and Greeks believed. Now, from what I understand, Paul was not a dynamic speaker. And we're going to get to a place in Scripture where we see that. But we know that one time while Paul was speaking, there was a boy, and he was asleep. He fell asleep in the window of the church, and he fell out, and he died. Paul couldn't have been that dynamic if the boy fell asleep in the corner there. Okay? And then Paul just went down and raised him from the dead, brought him back up, made him listen to the rest of the sermon. And that's what I'm going to do if you fall dead here. I have the same plan of attack. So he spoke effectively. It means effectively is knowledgeably, number one, and it's with the proper tone, number two, I think. Because you can be knowledgeable, but be pompous and arrogant, and I'm not going to want to listen to you either. There's something about balancing passion and purpose with tone and with knowledge. All right, but the Jews who refused to believe stirred up the other Gentiles and poisoned their minds against the brothers. So the other Jews are coming against them already. So Paul and Barnabas spent considerable time there speaking boldly for the Lord, who confirmed the message of his grace by enabling them to perform signs and wonders. So God kind of gave them a little bit extra. If they're going to teach, if they're going to teach, he also wanted to give them power. So it kind of just backed up the things that they preached. Yeah.
When you go back to the mission out there, if the Jews who refused to believe started up, the Gentiles, it's very interesting to me how that one decision, whether to believe or not to believe, how that affects your thinking. And so far in Acts, have we encountered any place where those who chose not to believe did not resort to violence?
No, we haven't. It's been, nobody has just peacefully went away and said, no, we're not going to believe that. Everybody has been passionate about it. What we talked about too last week too was that the Jews didn't seem to accept the message as quick as the Gentiles. Now the Gentiles just being anybody that's not a Jew. The Jews didn't accept the message that Paul taught, that Peter taught, that the disciples taught as quickly as the Gentiles. And one thing that I made a point on last week, and I think it would be true, and that's Matt's opinion, is that you've got to think that the Jews are steeped in religion. They have a lot of religious things to get over. Not a lot of relationship things, not a lot of things that are just to do with Jesus. They have a lot of religious foundation. And they were very proud of that heritage. Now, imagine it like this. Imagine you trying to convert somebody who is Muslim to Christianity. They're going to have a lot of religion that they're going to have to step through before they can accept Jesus. And I think that that was some of the problem with the Jews, is there was a lot of religious stuff that they had to get through. And it caused them to constantly question and then get mad because it felt like it was stepping on their heritage. To the point to even today that they don't believe in Jesus. All right. So Paul and Barnabas spent considerable time there speaking boldly for the Lord, who confirmed the message of his grace by enabling them to perform signs and wonders. It's like, hello, here is the message, and here is the power. We don't see that very much now. We hear the message, but we don't see the power. Here, when God showed up, he brought the message, and he brought the power. Verse 4, the people of the city were divided. Some sided with the Jews, others with the apostles. There was a plot afoot among both Gentiles and Jews, together with their leaders, to mistreat them and to stone them. I'm telling you, man, when they didn't like you back then, it was death. I mean, it's never just, hey, we'll ask you to leave. You know, every now and then you'll hear that in the Bible, but most of it was like, we stoned them, we killed them, we tried to get their life. It's always a big deal. Verse 6, but they found out about it and fled to, I'm not even going to try. Cities of Lystra and Derbe and to the surrounding country, where they continued to preach the gospel. Now, isn't it interesting? We always talk about being bold for the gospel, but when they found out that there was a threat against their life, they did leave. And they fled on down the road. Sometimes it's better to leave and to live than to stay and to die. Okay? I know that that's that way in arguments too, okay? Sometimes it's better to leave and to live than to stay and to die. There is a time to stay and die, but there's a lesson here again. Sometimes you just need to leave. Where they continue to preach the gospel. Now they're in Lystra and Derbe. All right, let's go back. I want to show you where Lystra and Derbe is. Lystra and Derbe, and I'm going to shout out my TV name and show. But Lystra and Derbe is right there in the teal color, right next to Iconium. You can see Derbe. It's like the third or fourth city here, starting at Damascus. It goes up at Snakes, then Derbe, and then on down to Lystra, which is interesting because that's about 100 miles between Derbe and Lystra just in that journey for Paul. It's crazy, the amount of space that they're taking each time. So it's like, oh, they just went on down the road to Lystra. No, they went 100 miles to Lystra from Derbe. Quite a distance there. Sorry to get off on that, but I wanted you to understand. In Lystra, there sat a man who was lame, and he had been that way from birth and had never walked. And he listened to Paul as he was speaking, and Paul looked directly at him, saw that he had the faith to be healed. There's something underlined in your Bible. Saw that he had the faith to be healed, and called out, "Stand up on your feet." And at that, the man jumped up and began to walk. Notice the relationship between the man having the faith to be healed before he actually received the healing. He had to have that faith first. Paul said he saw that he had the faith to be healed, and then he was healed. How many times did Jesus say, "Go, your faith's healed you"? Multiple times. It's not always in what Paul could do, but in what whoever it was could believe him to do. Isn't it amazing though that it wasn't a slow healing? I mean, this guy hadn't walked his entire life. It wasn't slow. It wasn't like, oh, he barely got up and then he stood and he caught his balance. No, it says he jumped up to his feet and then he began to walk. It wasn't, you know, like you see on TV sometimes when they'll be talking to somebody, they're going to heal somebody, and they slowly bring them up and they kind of wobble around. No, this is not like that. This is not like that. He jumped up to his feet and he began to walk. You know, babies, when they're born, they don't know how to walk yet. And they're learning. So they get up on their feet and they have to stand a while. Think about this. This man had never walked in his life, but he had the ability as soon as he was on his feet. It wasn't just a physical healing, but he had the mental capacity to walk once he was on his feet. How would you know how to do that if you had never done it? It's an interesting part of the scripture when you look at it. Stand up on your feet, and the man jumped up and began to walk. And when the crowd saw what Paul had done, they shouted in a certain language, "The gods have come down to us in human form." I bet you they did. Tyler, if you go out and you heal somebody, I'm going to believe you're God at that point. I'd be like, you're doing something pretty amazing. And they had no other option, though. I mean, some of these are Jews, but a lot of these aren't Jews. And, you know, they had to think, God has come down to man in some form when somebody can do something that I've never seen any other human do. So what, it has to be magic or it has to be God. And maybe it's a little abode. And so it says Barnabas, they called Zeus. And notice these, I believe these are Greek gods. Greek gods. Barnabas, they called Zeus. And Paul, they called Hermes because he was the chief speaker. Now Zeus is kind of like the god of all gods from what I understand. And anybody know a little bit more about Hermes? Do you know anything, Randy? I meant to look it up a little bit more, but I hadn't looked up Hermes. I might have some in my notes of that. The priest of Zeus, whose temple was just outside the city, brought bulls and wreaths to the city gates because he and the crowd wanted to offer sacrifices to him. Now, when they started in the other city. They started in the Jewish synagogue. But notice how different things are happening. You have a Jewish synagogue. Remember, in our other city, we had a temple to Venus. And it was the god of what? Sexual love is what they called it. So we had the god Venus in the other. And they were worshiping. And like we said, there was probably like a million people in that city. And they worshiped Venus. It's kind of crazy. Probably one of many gods. And then, now they have a temple to Zeus. And it's like he is the god of all gods in out of Greek gods. And so they brought bulls and wreaths to the city gates because he and the crowd wanted to offer sacrifices to them. So the priests of Zeus have seen these miracles, and they've never seen anything like it before. So they believe that Zeus and Hermes has come in man form, which is exactly what all of their teachings would show them, that sometimes God comes in human form. And they come down and they say, oh, we want to make sacrifice to him. It has to be our gods. How quickly they are to believe that. But when the apostles Barnabas and Paul heard of this, they tore their clothes and rushed out into the crowd, shouting, "Friends, why are you doing this? We too are only human like you. We are bringing you good news, telling you to turn from these worthless things to the living God, who made the heavens and the earth and the sea and everything in them. In the past, he let all the nations go their own way." In the past, if the nations wanted to go their own way, he allowed it to happen. But now, he's bringing the message of truth to all these nations. Yeah?
In that verse, I think in there, he says, we too are only human. But yet, he was healed the man.
Yeah.
So, it reminds me of that verse in the New Testament where Jesus said, all things are possible with that. And how we really should never use the word can. They're only human. What is humanity? What does it mean to be human? And then you have to ask the question, what does it mean to be human to be magnified by the grace of God?
You know, and I think we would explain that the best way possible to explain that is God working through man to accomplish his purpose. Now notice that they're not just healing to be healing, but they healed so that other people might believe that what they said was true. It's not like a circus act. It's not like he just shows up and he's like, oh, I'm going to heal everybody in town. Come see me. I'm a God. No, it's God allowed them to do miraculous things in order that they would believe the message. Because the message was what was most important. It was the message that brought life. And so God allowed them to do miraculous things in order that people might believe the message. And I wonder, you know, it wasn't just about the healing. It was about believing the message. And it always points back to that. It always points back. Why did Christ come out of the tomb? It points back to salvation for mankind. And so it's interesting. because, you know, we would think that it would just be, oh, they were sick and they needed healing, so that's why they did it, but it's really not. It's more of a, hey, in order that you might believe the message, we're going to do miraculous things. And you're going to see that God actually has the power that he says he has. Verse 17. Yeah, he has not left himself without testimony. He has shown kindness by giving you rain from heaven and crops in their season, and he provides you with plenty of food and fills your hearts with joy. Even with these words, they had difficulty keeping the crowd from sacrificing him. They're telling them that this God that they serve, that they just saw heal a man, provides them with rain and gives them crops and allows them to eat. And it made them so mad. They were fine when they were gods, but when he said, no, we're just a man that follows God, they get mad. And it says, even at this, they had trouble keeping the crowds from sacrificing. Oh, from sacrificing to them. Sorry, I misread that. From sacrificing to them. So even with this, they wanted to still lay on the praises of Paul and Barnabas. Then some Jews came from Antioch and Iconium and won the crowd over, and they stoned Paul, and that's what I was thinking is, they stoned Paul and dragged him outside the city thinking he was dead. Yeah, go ahead.
And verse 17.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, Sean Hines, by giving you right and right and props on his head. What makes me wonder is how much kindness God shows to us every single day that we're talking about.
Absolutely. I would guarantee it. And I wonder when we get to heaven if we'll somehow be able to have knowledge of the things that he was doing for us that we felt were just average, everyday things that were really the blessings of God. And I tell you, I know it's happening because I look at my life compared to the lives of some others who don't choose this way, and my life is free of a lot of chaos that could be there that I don't have to endure. I'm not free from troubles, but I am free from a lot of troubles. And I am blessed in a lot of ways that I look at other people's life and I go, they're going through this hard time and a lot of it's on them.
Even stuff happens to somebody and they think it's bad.
Yeah, even when we can't understand it.
Well, I mean, if you don't understand it, why do you need trust?
Yeah. I mean, if you already got it all figured out, why do you need God? All right, verse 18. Even with these words, they had difficulty keeping the crowd from sacrificing. The crowd wanted to believe that they were God. Isn't that interesting that they had such a hunger to see God and to see the power of God? There's always that hunger there. Every time you ever reach anybody, there's always a hunger to know a God and to see his power.
And they wanted him to be physical.
And they wanted him to be physical. Like they said, they wanted him to have skin on him. Have skin on him. Like the story I told before, Abram's dad tells the story a bunch of times, but it's the kid who goes and he's going to go to sleep and he says, he comes down and he says, I'm scared. He said, well, go up and pray that Jesus will lay down with you. And he comes back down a few minutes later. He says, I'm still scared. And he said, well, pray that Jesus will lay down with you. He'd come lay down with you. So he laid there, he prayed. A little bit later, he'd come back down, boom, 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 down steps again. Hey, I'm still scared. Just go up. Go up. Imagine it. You know what I'm talking about. So he goes up again and he's like, oh, he prays, God, lay down with me. And he comes down again and he's scared. He's still scared. It's still dark in this room. There's still monsters under the bed. He comes down and he says, I'm still scared. And they said, well, go up and pray. And he says, hey, I'll pray, but I need somebody with skin on. You know? Sometimes we just need somebody with skin on. That's why we need to be Jesus to other people. And sometimes people need to be able to put their arm around somebody. Verse 19, then some Jews came from Antioch and Iconium and won the crowd over, and they stoned Paul and dragged him outside the city, thinking he was dead. So these guys have been on Paul and Barnabas' trail. They followed them now from the other city, and they won people over and said, hey, follow us. And they stoned Paul, and they dragged him outside the city, thinking he was dead.
That's not a double-minded person.
Yep. A double-minded man is unstable in all his ways and should expect nothing from God. And these are the religious leaders that, like these people that are chasing them down, these are not Satanists. These are Jews. It's hard for us to believe. All right, verse 20. city. And the next day, he and Barnabas left for Derby. They thought he was dead. I mean, when you get stoned, it's not a very pleasant thing. And they left him for dead. Then he hops up, he walks back into the city.
I was thinking about this, man, I would love to have been there and see how he got it. You know, dude, just get up, that's not, and say, okay, guys, let's go over there.
You know, and I wonder too, why did they stone him again? They stoned him, they left him for dead, and then they drug him out there for dead, and then, you know, he does himself off, and you know, they have to just be like,
church stands there, we stoned you, and you gotta walk around.
Yeah, excuse me, I'm just gonna get on up and go on back about my business. And what's funny is, you know, you would think that after he got stoned, he would be kind of fearful, you know, and he would be like, okay, I'm gonna go back and I'm gonna get Barnabas, I'm gonna leave. No, he leaves the next day. He goes and gets Manoah's rest there in the city that just stoned him.
He had to hurt.
He had to hurt all the time. I mean, he's walking all the time, he's then he gets stoned. Man. Pretty crazy. I love that verse. I was looking forward to getting there. He got up. I just picture him. I'm just getting up. All right, let's go back on the table. You know, just go back where they just stoned him. And you know, there's people who still got the stone in their hand, you know, and they're standing in town when he walks back in. And they're just like, yeah. I mean, you know, you wonder if you lay awake at night, you know, like, oh, I just stoned Zeus, and he just got up and walked back. What is this going to mean for me? You know, we couldn't kill him, so I was one of the ones with the stone. Yeah, that's interesting. All right, they returned to Antioch in Syria. So they preached the gospel in that city and won a large number of disciples. Then they returned to Lystra, Iconium, and Antioch, strengthening the disciples and encouraging them to remain true to the faith. We must go through many hardships to enter the kingdom of God, they say. We forget this verse. That's one of those that Ron says are a Sharpie verse. You take the Sharpie. Highlight the other one, the Sharpie that one. And so, we must go through many hardships to enter the kingdom of God. That doesn't go with a lot of preaching that we see.
Why do you think that is?
Because nobody wants to go through hardships.
No, I mean, why must we go through many hardships? You know, one thing that comes to mind is whose planet are we on? Pam said the other day, she said, you know, if they invite me to live on the space station or go to another planet, she said, I'm going to go because I want to get away from the devil. Because this is his place.
I think it tests your character.
Yeah.
It tests what you really are like, believe. Because you can say a lot of things, but when it comes down to it, do you really believe what you say?
And I don't know that it's because I don't know that it's a direct relationship of, okay, in order to get to the kingdom, I'm going to have to do these things as much as it is. This is a fallen planet. I had it right the first time, and then it messed it up. And now, if you want to get to where I am, you're going to have to go through many hardships. It's kind of like what we talked about before when you walk out into your garage and you trip over that shovel. And it's the shovel that you put there the day before. I think these hardships a lot of times are directly related to the choices that we made before and the choices that were made for us before. It's definitely going to put you through problems. Now, I do understand that some things are demonic forces, but I do believe, too, that we give the devil a lot of credit for things that he don't ever do. Sometimes you make bad decisions and you get the result of your bad decisions. Sometimes other people make bad decisions, and you get the result of their decision. And really, the devil's just set back, and he's just started an event, and he's letting it roll. Yeah. You know? So I wonder about that. I wonder if it's just an inheritance of a fallen world that's causing the hardships. And because you've got to think, every hardship is birthed after a rebellion against Christ. And so if you take up his banner, you're going to take up his cross. And you're going to have to face those things. All right. Verse 23. Paul and Barnabas appointed elders for them in each church, and with prayer and fasting committed them to the Lord, in whom they had put their trust. So he established leadership to run the churches in his absence. That's wise. If I'm going to make this last, I'm going to have leadership to make sure what we've taught you is carried out. Because there are times in Paul's ministry where he chastises the people that he taught. And he gets on to them and he says, you've stopped doing the things that I told you to do. And now you have things going on that you don't like. But it's because you quit doing what I told you to do.
There's another point of leadership also. What if you don't have leadership? Or if you take a family and there's no leadership, what do you have?
Chaos. Chaos. A losing baseball. All of the above. And so, they appointed elders. And it's interesting. If you're gonna establish a religion that's gonna last, you're gonna have to lay down the philosophies of that religion, and then you're gonna have to have people to carry out things that you lay down. Now, how do we do that as a church? Where do we ever carry the gospel that when we leave there, we establish some form of leadership to help keep that thing going? Now, we always try to bring them back here, which is a good thing, but sometimes that can't happen. So how do we give people the beginnings, but we never give them the next step. It's kind of like a drive-through Christianity. And that's what we get back to when we point back to it and we say, well, many people don't know what they believe. And so they can't know what their philosophies are or how are they going to play out in their life because they don't ever really establish what they believe, which gets back to the first point, which was unintelligent conversation and not being able to carry on a conversation. I mean, if you've got someone who staunchly says that they do not believe in God, let me tell you, they have reasons why. And you're going to have to go up against the reasons why that they don't believe in God. Because maybe they used to, and they don't now, and they know people are going to come to them, so they know what they believe about not believing. I know that sounds crazy, but they do. They're some of the best debaters that you'll ever get into, someone who says that they don't believe in God. It's hard to turn that ship around. Okay, so when they reached the word, they went down to Italia. From Italia, they sailed back to Antioch, where they had been committed to the grace of God for the work they had now completed. Now, one thing I want you to realize, too, is it talks about after they went to a certain place, they passed that place, but they came back through that place again, teaching. Now, on arriving there, they gathered the church together, reported all that God had done through them, and how he had opened the door of faith to the Gentiles. And they stayed there a long time with the disciples. All right. So they stayed there a long time with the disciples. So what they're doing is they are now the first real modern missionaries. Paul and Barnabas are taking the gospel and they're carrying it out. Now, at the same time, the disciples are doing the same thing. They begin in Jerusalem and they're starting to fan out. They're starting to separate. The church in Jerusalem is pretty established at this point. There were thousands there when Peter left it. Remember, there was like, it was up to at least 5,000 by chapter 3 or 4. And it's probably doubled again. And so the church in Jerusalem is pretty established. And so everybody starts going in different directions and going to different places. That's how Thomas ends up in India. You know, he eventually ends up in India where he dies. And then now Paul, he's just gone all over the place. And we just get to follow him on his journeys. Yes.
Could you go back to that? I think it's the next or the last verse. What is it? appraised, and I want to see what you think about it. Committed to aggressive ground. I'm trying to follow.
Yeah.
Have been committed to the grace of God, what do you think? What's your thoughts on that?
Committed to the grace of God for the work they had now completed. What? Anybody have any thoughts on verse 26? What, committed to the grace of God for the work they had now completed? What were your thoughts on that? I think it is important what Eric was saying too. I think they went back to where they started their journey, but I want to look at the map and see that too. Yeah. It's down there on the coast. Remember, they started at one of the coastal cities there. So they went back. I think they took a boat actually and ended up in Italian. It doesn't have a red line put in this, but it does mention it in the other passage. So they went back to where they were committed to the grace. What is it, the grace of the gospel or the grace of God? That was verse, 26, right? Let's see what they say in this outline too. All right, it says that the words, the work which they had completed, it says, are beautiful, yet only partially true. Although the immediate mission was accomplished, the work of planting new churches and strengthening existing ones has never ended. So they were going back and they were re-strengthening those churches that they had established and establishing those leaders. And it says that, now in verse 27 and 28, it says that when they had come and gathered the church together, they reported all that God had done with them and how he had opened the door to the Gentiles. They reported all that God had done with them. They talked about their success with evangelism among the Gentiles and the blessing of God that it demonstrated, showing that the work which was being done in Antioch was not unique, but that God wanted to replicate this work all over the world. Remember when Gentiles received Jesus in Antioch, it was thought before then that it was just something for the Jews. You know, and he said, we came back and we reported about how all these Gentiles were accepting Jesus because we wanted them to understand that it wasn't just unique to Antioch that it happened, but this was something that God wanted to do for the entire world. Yeah, go ahead.
In King James version, it uses the word recommended instead of, it says, and then sail to Antioch from which they have been recommended to the grace of God for the work which they have fulfilled. And he's got another here, committed to the grace of God. And then he's got, and fulfilled is completed. I'll keep talking.
Go back to the first part of chapter 13. That's where all the elders and the prophets all got together and prayed over Paul and Barnabas. Committed them and sent them out. And I think this verse is just saying, you know, they completed that, what they were set.
What they were commissioned to do.
Expanding his grace and
Yeah, that's an important scripture that you point out to, Don, because it was very important last week in talking that the church had actually commissioned them to go. And they were committed to go because the church had sent them. And so this was their first journey based off of the church saying, we want you to go and take this message out. Now, you know, they said that the trip was a great success, basically. But you got to think about all the obstacles that they faced on this trip. Now, we talked about some of it last week. The confrontation with Elymas on Cyprus. You remember Elymas? Elymas was the wicked guy in chapter 13, that whose name was Bar Jesus, or Son of Jesus, and they didn't even like calling him that. So they called him Elymas, which meant like possessed woman or something like that. Elymas was just kind of what he was, it wasn't who he was. And so, but the guy Bar Jesus, and so they got so tired of him. Remember, they basically, what did they do to him? Do you remember what they did to him in chapter 13? They got tired of him, and they told him that they struck him with something. I can't remember what it was. Oh, blindness. They struck him blind in chapter 13. Remember, and told him that it would be a long time before he would see again because of the way he had acted. Yeah. And so they had that confrontation with Elymas. They also had, Mark, the one who wrote the Gospel of Mark, was along with them. He was younger. And he was along with them up to a certain point, but eventually he quit and went home. And so he kind of abandoned them on the trip. And then they also had this temptation to be adored by the people as a god. That's probably a greater foe than any of them at times, because you'd love to be considered a god. Most people would. They'd be like, they'd be fired up if somebody thought that highly of them. Yeah.
He said, yes, I am.
Yeah, and immediately died, didn't he?
Yes.
Yeah.
And worms with him.
Yeah. Yeah, that's not where you want to be. Now, you remember in verse, let's look at this. What's going on? Y'all got to start that. Hey, can y'all restart that for me, please? Sorry, I think I flipped it the wrong way. Down in the bottom right hand corner, there should be a little thing. Looks like a little square with sticks that kind of at the bottom below this thing.
Yeah. I'm trying to bring it over here to look at what he's talking about.
That's right. Whenever you guys get by, I'll go ahead and read it. Verse 14 through 18. It says, "But when the apostles Barnabas and Paul heard this, they tore their clothes and they ran in among the multitude, crying out and saying, 'Men, why are you doing these things?'" So you hear, remember that they call them gods. And he says, "But when the apostles heard this, they tore their clothes." Well, why did they tear their clothes? Well, for two reasons. First, to show that they were completely human. And second, it was instinctively a Jewish reaction to terrible blasphemy. So if somebody was blaspheming God, the first thing you did, you tore your clothes. No, not me. I'm not going to blaspheme God. And so it was a Jewish kind of reaction, but at the same time it was also to say, "Hey, we're human just like you are." It was a way of humbling themselves before the people and saying, "Okay, we are not gods. All right, let's get down to the level that we're all at." Also, looking through notes here on things that I feel like are good to bring up. Talk about in verse 19 and 20. These Jews came from Antioch and Iconium and won the crowd over. These Jews were not content to keep Paul out of their own region. Like I said, they had followed him and brought their persecution with him. It wasn't enough just to say, "Okay, get out of here, Paul. This is not good for you." But they followed him. And some of these Jews would have traveled more than 100 miles just to make Paul miserable.
You know, I hadn't noticed this before, but they stoned him, then they dragged him.
Yeah. It's like killing an old animal, just carrying it out to the dump, you know, throwing it out there. I mean, it is. That's what it's like. They stoned him right where he was, and then they said, "Not only that, it's not enough for us, we're going to make sure you're not even in this city anymore." And they drug him out. But amazing, like we talked about this two Sundays ago when we were talking about from king to criminal, was the fickleness of the crowd. How easy it is to persuade the crowd to do whatever you want them to do. Doesn't that make you feel kind of simple-minded? I mean, if you're in the crowd and the crowd is swayed one way and then swayed the other, it makes you feel kind of simple-minded because all these people are just like, "Okay, we think you're a god, Paul." And then it's like, "Hey, we're going to stone Paul." They're like, "Okay, let's do that." And think about society as a whole. The crowd's pretty fickle. And if they had a charismatic leader, the crowd could do a lot of damage. Think of Jim Jones, some of those guys. They followed those people, David Frisch. All it took was a charismatic leader, and the crowd was just swayed. That's scary. That's very scary.
Also, peer pressure. You know, in that crowd could cause you to show.
What happens today with media, with any kind of technology, you know, Facebook, whatever, it's just so easy to see one thing, and all of a sudden, all these people have that same opinion.
But getting back to what we were talking about earlier, too, is how often do people follow someone who doesn't seem intelligent? Turn to 2 Corinthians 11:25, and somebody turn to Galatians 6:17. And read those right quick. When you get them, just kind of tell me you got. Galatians 6:17 and 2 Corinthians 11:25. Yeah, Galatians. Read. All right. Read Galatians first. This is Paul again. Paul says, I bear on my body the scars that are the marks of Jesus. All right. Hillary, read 2 Corinthians 11:25.
Three times I was beaten with rods. Once I was pelted with stones. Three times I was shipwrecked. I spent a night and a day in the open sea.
Yeah. Paul is referring back to the experience that he just had in that scripture there to the Corinthians. He says, hey, I was stoned. And then he says, hey, I bear the marks of Jesus. His persecution he acquainted with his God and was something to be proud of. And he goes on to say, who of you have suffered more than I have for this cause? He's talking to the crowd and he says, that's why he's telling them, hey, I was shipwrecked. He was bit by a snake one time, shook it off. All these things happened to him. And it goes back to, again, that scripture that we looked at a minute ago where it said, see, you must suffer many hardships. What's that scripture? What was that?
Verse 22.
We must go through many hardships to enter the kingdom of God. Anytime that I think about hardships, I think about Paul.
We don't mean some aspects have really, really lot of meanings.
Yeah. It's interesting.
It is.
Now, we were talking earlier about we would go with a Sharpie and mark through that one. But what I was thinking about is Paul is standing in front of these guys. He's probably still banged up from the stoning. But he's trying to, he says that they're encouraging men to remain true to faith. So they see Paul walk in with a bunch of knots on his head. They think maybe this is not for me. And everyone would bail out. And then he tells them, you don't have to go through some hardship. And of course, as you mentioned, we don't really go through hardships here. And we would mark that out with black marking. Thinking that the people in the Mideast are converted Muslims, converted Hindi, and those types of people, they're getting a highlighter out big time.
Yes.
And they're saying, we're having to go through many hardships. because they are really actually going through hardships for the kingdom.
Yeah.
And we go through hardships, but like you say, most of them are self-inflicted.
Yeah.
I think Tyler mentioned a while ago how when we go through hardship, if we can carry our faith through that, when we get on the other side of it, we got a stronger faith and then we start through that hardship.
Right. And you know, it's for the martyr and for the person who's enduring hardship, like what Don's talking about, Paul is like a hero because he boasted of his scars. He boasted of them. And he likened them to the ones that Jesus had. And he was proud of that relationship that he had with Jesus. Even a relationship that meant, I take on pain to be like Jesus.
And it raises a very important question also. How can we expect Jesus to go through what he did and us not experience some inside of him?
Right. Exactly. Well, we could talk about this all night, but we're running out of time tonight, but it's getting interesting. Everywhere he goes, everything that Paul does, from here on out, it just gets better. I mean, it just gets better. He everywhere he goes, he has a difference. But it gets better if you like reading fiction novels. That's the way it feels like, because it's like he goes into this town and something crazy happens, and he ends up on a ship, and he's a prisoner, and then it wrecks, and then he's in the ocean, and you know, it's like they're about to kill all the prisoners because they don't want them to swim off and get free, and then they wreck the boat. He doesn't die. It's weird that they ever wreck. You know, I'm surprised that Paul didn't just die of old age after you beat so many things. You know, John basically died of old age, and they tried to tar and feather him, and it didn't hurt him. It didn't kill him. I ain't gonna say it didn't hurt him, but it didn't kill him. It's just interesting that eventually that God allowed Paul's life to be taken from him after he saved him from so many other things. Let's pray. God, I love you. Thank you for another night that God was encouraged to study Acts, God. I just encouraged us to learn more. And God, there, who knows what times lie ahead for all of us, God. But I thank you, God, that you're in control. And even if we have to die for you, that once we die, we will die again. That you've already conquered it all. When you rolled the stone away, you made sure that we didn't have to do it once. And God, I just praise you for it, that you hold the keys to death. And I'll live until you tell me I'm not going to. And not a minute more or a minute less. There ain't nobody that can take that from me. So I thank you, Lord, for tonight. I thank you that we get to study about the scars, Lord, that Paul endured for you, and the scars that you endured for us, God. In your name I pray. Amen.